Scott Sloan. This is News Radio 700 WLW, and this is kind of scary because I've got a friend probably going through this right now, more than that a little bit. But, you know, we all get sick from time to time. Sadly, some of us get sick, and it's critical. Maybe it's a car accident. Maybe, well, as we saw in Dayton, it's a tornado, right? Number of people injured. Fortunately, nothing serious there. And if we're having a crisis like this and we have a medical condition that needs urgent care, which would be going to the ED, the emergency department. Sometimes you're driven there, maybe drive yourself there. All too often, though, it's going to be an ambulance. It may even be an air ambulance, right? Life flighted in places like that. I was in Westchester yesterday, saw the life flight helicopter touching down at Cincinnati Children's. I always say a little prayer because whatever's happening in that helicopter is not good. And that's life-changing if you see one of those things. And you pray it's not for you or a family member. But you go to the hospital, you're transported in that fashion. But it, little do people know is when you're fighting for your life and eventually you turn the corner, you get better, that you may not have been transported to a hospital that is in network. And that means you get the bill. And is that right? I would say, no, that's wrong, because you often don't have a say when you're facing trauma like that. You're going to be taken to the closest available equipped medical center, regardless of what your insurance card says. But that's the problem. Finally, politicians are addressing this. There is a proposal, bipartisan legislation, to tackle the issue of surprise medical bills. On that, Seth Denson is our go-to guy when it comes to healthcare and analyzing healthcare. He's the president and co-founder of GDP Advisors. Seth, good morning. Welcome to the show on the acutehearingcenters.com hotline. How are you?
Good morning, Scott. Good to be with you. Listen, doing well. Thanks. Good. Hope you had a great long weekend.
Yeah, we did up here. We had some tornadoes in Dayton and right here in our backyard. And, you know, fortunately, it could have been a lot worse, but it wasn't. Some injuries, one death. And, you know, but again, you know, if you're one of those persons and you're transported to the hospital, it's kind of where we're hitting. You asked anybody yesterday, am I going to be involved in a tornado? The answer would be no. And these things happen. Should you be penalized because you get caught in a situation that you don't generally choose and you're transported to the closest hospital? That seems patently unfair to me that you would be billed on a network, which is, I mean, you're literally talking tens of thousands of dollars in a lot of these cases, right?
You are, and this is what we have coined as surprise billing, is what the industry calls it. The president calls it that. Came out recently saying he was going to do something about it. And I don't know what I'm more shocked to see, is it were these bills or the fact that we have some bipartisanship going on in Washington to do something about this. Although I'm really thrilled about the latter, and I'm hoping that it's a good first step. Listen, this is one of those just ridiculous aspects of our current healthcare system in the United States that this is even allowed. And I'll take it a step further. Oftentimes, it's not necessarily that you're taken out of network to an emergency room. It's that you're seen by out-of-network doctors when you're there. So this adds an extra layer of confusion to the patient who goes into an emergency room, and that emergency room happens to be in network with their insurance company, but all the people staffing that emergency room aren't. How's a patient to know that? And unfortunately, 3 to 6 months later, they'll get a bill in the mail letting them know and saying that they owe this money. So I'm excited to see that Washington is taking steps to really set some good ground rules by which the consumer needs to be protected. This isn't Washington getting in and doing Medicare for All or single payer or any of that. It's allowing the consumer to have the information so they can take matters in their own hands and make good decisions, but be protected when the information isn't provided to them.
Yeah, and I think that's prudent. You know, if you have elective surgery, you have time to plan where you're going, in network, out of network, whatever. And some people chose to do that because they want a different standard of care than what their insurance company may offer. I understand that. But, you know, when you are in a situation where it's life or death, you know, you don't have control over which doctors are looking at you or what emergency room go to generally, especially if you're unconscious or something like that. And as you said, Seth, good to see that there's some bipartisanship. Although what scares me is we thought we were going to have movement on infrastructure just a week ago with Trump and Pelosi, and look what happened there.
We're only one tweet away always from change in the climate of the political sphere, aren't we? You know, this I will tell you on this legislation, here's what'll be interesting though, Scott, is what is in the details of it. And I'll give you a perfect example. We were talking internally at GDP, my firm, the other day about what this could look like, and because this bill only attacks emergency rooms and emergency type situations. But let's say that I have showing symptoms of potential cardiac arrest or something of that sort, go to the emergency room only to find out maybe I had one too many burritos at lunch and it's indigestion, right? And so where's the protection there? Because now all of a sudden this isn't classified as an emergency visit. The insurance company is not going to treat it as an emergency visit. And yet I'm still going to get a bill. And so this is a great first step, but what I would say is we still have a long way to go. And one of the things that I've long talked about, I've mentioned on your show, I've got a whole chapter in my book that's coming out on this, is the fact that insurance networks are no longer a plausible option in the United States. We need to do away with them completely and go back to what insurance originally was, which is protecting the consumer at the time services are rendered, and I'll make them work with the hospital systems and duke it out, but don't leave the burden on the consumer.
Yeah, that makes sense a lot. Hopefully they can do that. Now, how receptive are insurance companies? What's their defense of this?
Well, they're not receptive because this is one of those things that they get to pan off, and it's a good negotiating tactic when they go in and negotiate these network contracts with the large hospitals is, hey, we're going to protect you guys because we're going to give you this veil of secrecy by which to operate behind. So in the law also, what has been proposed at least, from what I've researched, isn't saying who's going to be responsible here. It's saying, hey, the patient isn't responsible. Insurance company, hospital system, you guys duke it out and figure it out. And so nobody, the insurance company nor the hospital are going to like that because now they got to get attorneys involved and then we got a whole nother set of expenses. At the end of the day, there has to be another layer of protection to the consumer that this doesn't come full circle and hit the consumer right in the middle of the eyes with raising insurance premiums. But again, we kind of move back into this vicious cycle of today's healthcare system and the way it operates.
Yeah, and that's really part of the problem is you're caught up in this thing and I have no idea if I'm in network, out of network, or if the clinician is going to be in network, out of network, if I'm lying on my deathbed in an emergency room because I had a heart attack or a stroke or a car accident or involved in a tornado or something along those lines. And you don't see that coming. And what is your responsibility as a patient? It's not like you can discharge that bill. How do you work that out? Let's say that I have a heart attack. I go to the ER. They save my life the whole bit. And a few months later, I get a bill for $80,000. How do I wind up paying that off?
Well, that therein lies the problem, right? I'm dealing with an issue right now for one of our clients who specifically went into an in-network hospital, was told they were in-network, and now the in-network hospital is saying, yeah, we have another division of our hospital that's out of network, and we're billing this service through that instead. And so this is, you're scratching your head going, wait a minute, you told the patient you